Thank you for tuning in to the Street Rider Podcast. My name is Noah, aka Big Mex, and on this series, we're looking at the history of the brawler. The last time we left off, we were at about the year 1988, so we've got a lot of big changes coming up. The games featured today were the best examples of how the brawler were shaping the game industry and creating subgenres in its wake. 1989 was a year that showed it was not simply enough to follow the trend. Studios had to innovate and change the genre in order to keep the momentum going. The first title that we're going to talk about was a sort of high watermark for the brawling subgenre, better known as the hack and slash. Golden Axe, developed by Sega, was a sword and sorcery take on the brawler. It featured three characters: a barbarian-like warrior known as Axe Battler, a dwarf named Gilius Thunderhead, and a female warrior named Tyrus Flair. All three fought with weapons instead of their bare hands across a medieval fantasy setting. They could take down rogues, bandits, and monsters. In several portions, the characters could even mount dragon-like creatures and burn down opponents. The trio of fighters were said to defeat a barbarian lord named Death Adder, which I always thought was a really cool name, before he could claim the Golden Axe and the kingdom that followed it. Golden Axe was important to the history of the brawler for a number of reasons. The design and magic system that went along with it was something that really hadn't been tried before, although it was infamous for a soundbite or two that they ripped off the movie Conan the Barbarian. The characters were fun, but for the adolescent boys playing, the warrior Tyrus was a memorable one. A perfect tan, a toned figure, and a tiny white bikini weren't quite the things people thought of as suitable for a warrior until Tyrus came along. Tyrus also sported the most powerful magic attacks in the game, making her a practical choice and not just a sex object. The fantasy themes worked well for the genre, but were cemented by the exotic locations featured on the travels to find Death Adder. One level, which appeared like an island, actually took place atop a giant sea turtle as it moved from port to port. Another branching path was set on the back of a giant eagle. Branching paths was a new feature in video games, and Golden Axe was among the first, if not the first, arcade title to use them. Incorporating a tremendous sense of scale had not been done in any previous brawler. The magic system itself was completely unique among brawlers. Players collected magic vials by hitting tiny thieves. Each level of magic required a set amount of vials. Once the player had collected them, they could activate the magic at any time. The more vials required to activate a spell, the more damage it did to opponents. Players learned to save a magic attack for when they were surrounded by opponents or the final boss himself. By this point, the industry was clearly interested in the brawler, and they were trying to bring the experience to home systems. Technos released a variation of the brawler with a Japanese high school theme titled Downtown Neketsu Monogata. It was set in the same continuity as the arcade title Neketsu Koa Kunio-kun. For a while, Technos actually had Kunio-kun act as a mascot. When the game came out for the Nintendo Entertainment System in North America, we knew it better as River City Ransom. The limited processing power, color palette, and memory of the NES meant that there was no way the 8-bit console would be able to match anything that the arcade had. Technos succeeded in creating a memorable brawling experience by creating small, stylized figures out of the Japanese high school characters. Sometimes they were called chibi or super deformed. I think chibi was reserved for humans, super deformed for robots. The smaller figures required less detail and animations, and the memory saved on limiting the detail on each character meant that more rivals could be drawn on screen by the processor. To keep the NES from being overworked, the environment was limited to a strict, flat battleground, while still allowing for backgrounds to change and show that characters were advancing through the city. In the end, it was a pocket version of the brawler and proof that consoles were capable of carving their own niche in the genre. With that said, Konami was going to point out how the arcade brawler could get away with things not allowed by Nintendo's policies, which were a form of, some would argue, game censorship. In the arcade, Konami released Crime Fighters. It was a large, four-player cabinet featuring generic characters wearing white t-shirts and four different colored pants. Talk about taking the quick road to character design. The game was notable for a few reasons. The designers created large, detailed environments for the four players to fight in and around. The characters were smaller than those featured in other brawlers, but proportional, unlike the River City Ransom figures. The game pandered to just about every adolescent boy's fantasy. It was a cool version of New York, with plenty of brightly colored graffiti covering the walls and lots of fighting. It was extremely violent as well, more so than even Double Dragon. Rivals could knee the player in the groin, and players could hit opponents with lead pipes and even use a handgun, which was against the code of fair fighting for most brawlers. There was also a bit of sex appeal, with a lot of cleavage shown in a billboard early on in the game, not to mention that rival female gang members were dressed like dominatrixes and used whips on the players. Crime Fighters would never have been released on a Nintendo console without some serious retooling. The game itself was fun, but very difficult. Every credit gave players a set amount of health, and that health counted down slowly. Taking damage from opponents caused the energy to drain faster. Thankfully, some of the damage could be recovered at the end of the level based on how many opponents were defeated. That was, of course, if the player managed to beat the boss characters. The bosses were larger variations of the gang members, each boss having a gimmick, like wielding a chainsaw or fighting with wrestling moves. The hardest part of the game was the end, in which all of the bosses had to be defeated in a battle royale. Konami wasn't mincing things. They wanted one of the most difficult and quarter-hungry games of all time. It did fairly well in arcades. However, there was another brawler released that same year, which took the lion's share of arcade profits. Final Fight by Capcom was their heir apparent to Double Dragon. In fact, the producers went into the project trying to dethrone the game. For the most part, it was mission accomplished. Visually, the game was a great leap ahead of the title brawler. The sprites were larger, more detailed, and better animated. The designs of the heroes and rival Mad Gear gang members would become brawling archetypes. For players, there was a large and powerful character that moved slowly but could deal great damage with his wrestling moves. There was also a smaller martial artist that struck very quickly and whose punches and kicks could stun opponents approaching from any direction. Then there was a character in the middle that had strength and speed at his disposal. For the gang members, there were character types that mirrored the heroes. The world they inhabited, a certain metro city, would become part of Street Fighter canon. The plot of this game was familiar. A girl was kidnapped, and a team had to come to her rescue. Arcade players were treated to a shot of Jessica Hagar in her bra tied to a chair. This bit of skin already made the game more mature than other brawlers. This show would be toned down and even removed in future revisions and home versions. It turned out she was the daughter of Mike Hagar, the mayor of Metro City. The former champion pro wrestler recruits Jessica's fiance, Cody, and his martial arts trainer, Guy, to go into battle. The rest of the game was a lesson in flawless design and execution. Players were taken through the boroughs of Metro City on their way to rescue Jessica from the crime lord, Belger. The Mad Gear gang members hanging out seemingly every few feet, waiting for their chance to take on the advancing heroes. Along the way, new boss characters were introduced. Sodom, Rolento, and Dory, and Abigail, that would become legendary in future Capcom fighting games. Final Fight had the right amount of difficulty and challenge. Patient players could pick off most of the opponents and use all of the time available to them to clear each stage with a minimal amount of health lost. Those that wanted to go all out and have all three players on the screen at once for some mayhem could do the same at the risk of wasting plenty of quarters. Those that went full tilt into the game experienced the best that the brawler had to offer. The arcade was the original social gaming experience. Players did not have the luxury of being connected to a network and having players across the country or around the world be able to drop into the action. If a player needed help clearing a stage, then a friend or family member would have to be standing with them, fighting the good fight. Ask any player that remembers clearing a fighting game how much fun was had when the battle was a shared experience. Memories were made and bonds grew stronger when players could say that they fought from beginning to end with a good friend. It was that way for my brother and our friends when we visited the Cal State Long Beach campus while still in high school. We were on a school field trip, and Final Fight had just been released. A brand new cabinet was waiting in the campus arcade. Instead of enjoying our lunch, my brother and friends decided we were going to beat the game and earn the bragging rights among the other gamers at school. The risk of not eating was not as big as missing the bus back to school. We were determined that nothing was going to stop us and play through level after level, frantically running back and forth between the change machine and the cabinet to keep us engaged when the lives started running out, defeating wave after wave of the relentless Mad Gear gang members with a combination of shoulder throws, jumping pile drivers, and spinning back kicks. Surviving the cheap shots by bosses and their countless minions, getting a small group of classmates gathered around the machine rooting us on, and at long last kicking Belger out of a window and reuniting Cody with Jessica. Those memories would never be replaced in our collective consciousness. It was more than 30 years ago today, yet the memories remain vivid as ever, proof that gaming could have a profound impact on our lives. Yet the brawler would not be done shaping our gaming taste. The new decade would see the genres pulled in many different directions all at once. In the next part, we're going to talk about how the 1990s saw some of the most defining moments in all of gaming. I hope to see you back for that. As always, if you enjoyed this podcast and would like to sponsor me, please visit my Patreon page. I'm Street Writer when you visit Patreon. Every little bit helps, of course, to try to do more research or just to try to keep my computer running. Have a great one, and we'll see you on the next episode.